Okay, so today is November 6, 2020. My name is Chelsea Wen, and I'm here interviewing Monique Truong for Houston Asian American Archive. So to start off, can you tell me where and when you were born?
Sure. Hi. I was born in Saigon on May 13th, 1968.
Mm-hmm. And can you describe the community that you grew up in?
So is that question about the first 6 years of my life?
Yeah, as much as you can remember, or you can just talk about how you moved when you were six.
Okay. Well, I lived the first six, almost 7 years of my life in Vietnam. My family had a home in a city called Cung Tơ, which is along the Mekong Delta. My father worked for Shell Oil. So the home we lived in was situated within the Shell Oil compound in Cung Tơ, which I understand no longer exists, nor the villa that we lived in no longer exists as well. And then also because my mother's side, the family is from Saigon, we also had a home in Saigon. I would describe my first six years of life in Vietnam as being from a economically privileged background. I remember growing up in a home that had multiple live-in help, people who cooked and cleaned, and I grew up mainly with a nanny. My memories of my life back then was pretty much kind of an idyllic childhood, even though the country was in the midst of a civil war. Like I said, my family came from an economically privileged background. So I went to school, I had play dates. My life was filled with privileges. And then towards the end of the Vietnam War, basically on April 22nd of 1975, my mom and I were flown out of Saigon via a cargo plane belonging to the US military, along with other Vietnamese who had connections with the US government. And this was the day after President Thiel had made his resignation speech, but certainly before anyone, not anyone, but most people thought that the country would fall to North Vietnam. So again, that privilege extended to the way that we were able to leave Vietnam as refugees. My father stayed as part of the bargain of getting my mother and myself out safely. And he left by boat, the way that many Vietnamese refugees left, and he left via Cung Tơ as part of an exodus that included members of the U.S. Consulate in Cung Tơ at the time. And his journey was very different from ours. And I And my father eventually ended up at a relocation camp in Arkansas called Fort Chaffee. And my mother and I ended up in a different relocation camp called Camp Pendleton, which was in San Diego or nearby San Diego, California. I can tell you that my life was very different upon arriving here in the US, but we can talk about that more later.
So how was your experience at Camp Pendleton? How long did you stay there?
You know, I have tried to ask my mother many times for an exact number of weeks. And you may find this to be the case with other sort of refugees, is that sometimes it's very difficult to get our elders to speak about that time, you know? And it's hard for me to understand whether she just didn't know or blocked it out or doesn't want to go there. And I speak about my mother because my father has passed away. And I was actually going through some of the emails that he had sent me prior to his passing. And I noted that, you know, he wrote that it was, I think he said that he spent around 5 weeks total, you know, in the various sort of places that he ended up as a refugee. So that actually was not a very long stay, if it was indeed 5 weeks or 6 weeks. And the lore within my family, and I say lore because it's really, again, hard to pin down dates, is that my father was very eager to leave the relocation camps. And he actually was very proactive about trying to reach out to Americans whom he knew in order to get our family sponsored. And with sponsorship was the only way that we would be able to leave the camps. So the short answer is that it was, I would say, you know, given what my father's written, 5 to 6 weeks.
And then how was he able to find a sponsor to move you guys out?
Well, this was someone whom he had worked with in Kanto. And this man lived in a very small town in North Carolina called Boiling Springs, and he agreed. And again, the lore there is that my father reached out to many Americans whom he had worked with or had social ties with, and many of them would not commit to sponsoring our family. And I was always told it was because they too were shell-shocked at what had happened, and trying to sort of piece their life together. So there weren't actually a lot of options available to my father and my family. It was this man who was kind enough to say yes. And that's how we ended up in Boiling Springs, North Carolina.
So what was it like to grow up in Boiling Springs?
Well, my family arrived in 1975, sometime during the summer. I had turned 7 years old in Camp Pendleton. And our family lived there from 75 to 78, right? So I was 7 to 9, 7 to 10 years old. And the town was and still is incredibly small. And there were very, there were no Asian Americans in my elementary school, Welling Springs Elementary School. And it was exceedingly difficult and an emotionally brutal place to grow up. Because of the daily bullying that I went through. And I, now you imagine that, you know, for the first 6 years of my life, I'm living, I understand myself as being a little girl, you know? And then all of a sudden, it did feel like this, all of a sudden. I am in this little town where I go to school and there was nothing about me that was normal. You know, everything was a problem. And I had no way of understanding that, you know, that my body was now something that was a problem, that somehow overnight I was sort of, there was this sort of projection upon my body that I have yellow skin. What? You know, and that my eyes were not shaped properly, that they were slits and slants, and that there was something wrong with my straight black hair, and that my name was something that was something to be made fun of, you know? And I think part of the problem with this context is that I wasn't growing up with siblings, you know? So I had no other child who was like me, and there were no other Asian Americans in my school for me to even get a understanding of that, of what had happened, what the social landscape was, right? And my parents were very much, you know, sort of, they were truly shell-shocked. They were desperately trying to get their life together. And it was very easy and necessary, I would have to say, for them to just, you know, kind of let me be, you know. And what they could tell me was that the children around me were just ignorant. They didn't know any better, you know? But that does not help a child. You can't just say that and let a child fend for herself, you know, on a daily basis in this environment. And that's what happened to me. And I learned how to speak English there. I actually learned how to speak English before I even got to school by watching television over the summer. I was watching Sesame Street, so, and I had come over during that magical age when it was still possible to learn a language as if you were drinking water. You know, it was kind of, I just absorbed it, you know? And that was a really good thing, because once I got to school, there were certainly no English as a second language courses there. They never had any foreigners, you know? So there were certain, I remember there were certain sounds in the English language that I was still unable to master, like the sound of TH, right? I'm sure there were others. And I was placed into a class that was for children with speech impediments. So I was, that is, again, just a very early and brutalizing example of what it meant to be a foreigner and other within that academic environment, you know. So that's where that's where I grew up, and it was also where I decided that I wasn't gonna develop a Southern accent. I know that seems kind of unusual for a child of that age, but I knew from watching television that not everyone spoke with a Southern accent. And there was something in me that said I would not sound like the people around me. And it was a decision. It wasn't happenstance. And I think that has to do with the brutality that I experienced there.
So do you think that your early childhood experiences have made you a stronger person?
It made me who I am today. Does that mean I'm a stronger person than if I had grown up in an environment as a child where, you know, where I could just simply be a child? I don't know. I don't believe in that narrative that hardship and abuse creates a stronger human being. It creates a human being that learns how to survive. But that comes with it, I think, a lot of psychological issues, a lot of mental health issues communities such as my own among the Vietnamese Americans, I feel that we are just beginning to talk about that kind of trauma and the mental health implications of it and what's passed down from generation to generation.
So as you grew up, were you able to find a community of Asian Americans?
Well, after my family left Boiling Springs, we moved to another very small town, not as small, not as homogenous in terms of race. And that was in Centerville, Ohio. And that's where I went to middle school. And then after that, from the time that I started high school, which was from 82 to 86, my family was in Houston, Texas. And Houston, and to be specific, we were in Southwest Houston in an area called A-Leaf. And even then, it was certainly much more racially diverse than any other place that I had been. And the high school had, I really don't know the exact number, but to me, it felt like a significant number of Asian Americans, Vietnamese American, Chinese American, Korean American, so on, South Asians. But I have to say that by the time I got to high school and to Houston, I had already developed a sense of myself as not being part of any group because I didn't belong for so long that it was actually hard for me to then make real social connections and ties with my fellow Vietnamese American students, you know, who had, it felt like many of them had, you know, grown up in Houston, gone to school together, had this whole kind of network already. And the way that I defined myself was not as an Asian American or as a Vietnamese American at that point, was simply as being some sort of freak, you know, so that's how I sort of navigated through high school. I listened to alternative music. I dressed differently. My hair was cut different than the folks around me. I was in a small group of other freaks, and that's how I understood myself.
So how would you say your parents raised you, and what expectations do they have for you?
Well, I think my parents expected of me what I think many Vietnamese American sort of refugee parents expected of their children, which is obedience. Achieving in school, you know, being academically successful. And I was exactly that child until I hit high school. I was still academically achieving, but I was no longer obedient. I didn't look like the other students or the, you know, or the children of their friends. And I think that was disconcerting and strange for them. But the only thing that allowed me to survive and for them to survive with me was the fact that I still keep my grades extremely high. But I stopped being that incredibly obedient child.
So do you have any siblings?
Yes, I do. And the stories, it's not an easy answer. So I have an older half sister, and a younger sister. My older sister is half Swiss French and half Vietnamese, and she grew up in Switzerland with her mother, who was my father's first wife. And my younger sister was born in Ohio, and there's an 11 years age difference between us.
So how was your relationship with your younger sister growing up?
Well, I didn't really grow up with her. I mean, the first years of her life, certainly, but by, you know, I really missed her the development of her as a, you know, like a person with a personality, because I, you know, was already in college by then, you know. So my relationship with her was almost non-existent for many years. And she, you know, she went to the same high school I did in Houston. We had some of the same teachers, you know, but she had a very different growing up experience than I did. And so that also kind of divided us, or kept us, you know, from becoming very close. And we are still very different today.
So how did you decide what you wanted to study in college?
I was a literature major at Yale. One of the things to keep in mind is that there was also an English major at Yale. The requirements were very different. English at Yale at that might still be, I'm not sure. But then it was very much about having a foundation in the literature of England. You know, and a literature major allowed you to do more theory, and it also allowed you to take more classes in international literature, you know. And that's what interested me. I have been an avid reader since coming, well, even before coming to the US, I was an avid reader, you know. And it certainly wasn't what my parents had hoped for, you know. But I think by that point, they were just sort of happy that I had gotten into an Ivy League school. Because to them, that meant, you know, I had achieved something that would put me towards a road to financial stability. How I was going to do that, they weren't quite sure with a literature degree. And I wasn't sure either.
So when you were at Yale, did you also feel, as a student in high school, kind of like an outsider, or you said like a freak?
Yes, but there were more of me. There were more freaks. Mm-hmm. And that was incredibly comforting. But I'll tell you that also at Yale was where I developed an understanding of my identity as an Asian American, and as a Vietnamese American. And that came about by you know, taking Asian American studies classes. It was the first time that I had studied some of the the history of Asians within the United States, and so much of it is painful. And so much of it is shocking in terms of our treatment. And it really was sort of the beginning of my political consciousness. I wasn't just taking Asian American studies classes. I was taking African American literature courses. I was taking classes that put me into direct contact with all of the history of United States that hadn't been taught to me in high school.
So is any of that, did any of that contribute to you deciding to go into law?
Yes. I know exactly when I understood that the law was a necessary path, which was when I studied the history of the Japanese American internment during World War II. It was shocking to me that American citizens could be rounded up, their property could be taken away and treated like the enemy. And and I think the thought process then was that I needed to make sure that I had a way to protect myself, my family, my community.
So did you feel like you were able to do that?
With my law degree?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is what I learned in law school. That there's a difference between what is legal and what is just. And they're not necessarily the same thing. So what does that mean? It means that the law alone is not going to be enough. That a community organizing, that that a kind of, there has to also be political strength, economic strength, strength of representation. It's a whole package. The law alone is not going to save us. I also learned in law school that I actually wasn't that interested in the law. And I learned that during probably the first week or two. And I say that because I've always been I love to study. I love learning. And what was happening in my law school class, I went to Columbia Law, City of New York, was that I did not think that what I was being taught was to think that critically. It was, you know, I wasn't surrounded by people who were necessarily curious, not necessarily that intelligent, you know? They were very good students. They got very high scores on their LSATs. They did all the reading, but that's not the same as being an intelligent, curious, creative thinker. And I didn't want to be surrounded by people like that for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm. So how long did you continue practicing law or being in law school?
Well, I stayed in law school. I graduated. I passed the New York bar. I practiced law full-time for 3.5 years. And another half year off and on as a temp lawyer, a part-time lawyer. This was already when I was starting to, you know, work on my first novel. I stayed in law school because of something that I think many refugees and immigrants from everywhere can relate to, which is our families really never taught us to quit, even when to quit was probably a healthier thing to do. We were taught how to endure, you know, and that's what I did. I endured my 3 years of law school. I endured practicing law. I started out as a litigator in a large law firm in New York. And I did it basically until my, until I could tell that my body was starting to give out and my emotional health was starting to give out. And when I say my body, I really mean that. I was developing a twitch in my eyelid because of the stress. I was developing a frozen shoulder where one side would lift up and wouldn't go back down. I mean, I was, you know, I was a young person. These things should not be happening. I looked much older than my age. And then when I say about my emotional health, by the time that I finally stopped practicing, I was crying every single day as I commuted to my firm. You know, I'd get on the subway, cry, and cry all the way to the office, where I would stop crying because you don't cry in the office. You know, so I thought, if I continue this, I wasn't gonna be around. You know, I would have to find some exit, and I didn't think it was gonna be a healthy way, whatever that exit was gonna be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do you think the stress was from the rigor of the job, or you also realized that you didn't, it wasn't somewhere you wanted to be?
Well, you know, I'll tell you that being a young associate at a large law firm in the city of New York is actually not that difficult. If you've, you know, gone through law school, if you made it this far, you can do it. It's not difficult because it's a lot of grunt work. It's not intellectual work. You're basically making sure copies have the right number of pages. You're making sure there's no typo. You're basically the last set of eyes, you know, on a document. So in that sense, no, the work wasn't hard. And even when I was, you know, writing and analyzing a particular problem, that also wasn't hard, you know? But what was hard was the fact that I was surrounded by people who thought that it was part of the profession to brutalize other people, to treat people as if they were dirt. And it's a very hierarchical work environment. And the way that they treated support staff was even worse. Secretaries, paralegals, the people who actually did the photocopying, as if these people were not humans, you know? And the way that they treated young associates was very much like, you are lucky to be here. You are lucky to have this job, you know? And sure, but I also earned it. You know, I earned the right to be in that position. And I was, if I ever had, you know, if I, there were moments where I would talk to older associates or more senior associates or, you know, about what was going on. And of course, I mean, the clear response was that it's a hazing process. It's a hazing process. And also that you just have to develop a thicker skin, you know? And I always thought about that. I thought, no, I don't want to develop the kind of skin where that kind of abuse is okay. I've already gone through that abuse as a child, you know, in Boiling Springs, that kind of bullying, you know, behavior. No, again, I could not withstand that kind of work environment and ethos.
Mm-hmm. So can you describe how you began to transition out of law and into writing?
Sure. One of the first things I did when I moved to New York was that I knew that there was a literary arts organization here called the Asian American Writers Workshop. And I had heard about it when I was in college. So when I came to New York to go to law school, I searched them out. They were located then in the East Village on St. Mark's Place, in a sub basement underneath a gap. And it was, I remember walking in there and there were like a couple of very tall bookcases towards the front. They sold books, but they were also a place for you to come and just read the books if you'd like. They also held creative writing workshops. They also had readings there. It was just sort of more of a community center than anything. And I mentioned those bookshelves because that was pretty much the extent of Asian American literature back then, was what could fit in those bookshelves. They didn't need more than two tall bookshelves, you know. And there was no work by Vietnamese Americans. But it was an incredibly important place for me because I started to meet and to understand what the life or the beginning paths of a literary life could be, you know? You know, I met people who had gotten their MFA in fiction or poetry, and some people had not, but still were starting to publish. And what was clear was that they were all much happier. Just there was a lot of joy in their lives. You know, it doesn't mean that their life was easier in any other way. I mean, there was still rent to be paid. There was still student loans to be paid, all of that. But they were still able to find a lot of joy. And I thought to myself, this is what I want to do. I want to have some joy in my life, you know? And I started volunteering for them. I started to, the first thing I did was I helped to co-edit an anthology of Vietnamese American poetry and prose. And that was called Watermark. That was published in 97. And then I continued to be their fiction editor for their literary journal that comes out of there. And then it was really, the transition really came when I wrote something new for the anthology that I was co-editing. I wanted to submit something, and so I took advantage of the fact that I had unlimited, it was pretty much unlimited sick days at the law firm. No one took the sick days, but I did. I took, I think, 3 days, sick days, and I wrote a short story. And that short story became the second chapter of my first novel. And that kind of, that started everything. It redirected my goals in life. And the goal became finding the financial means to be able to finish that book, and that freed me. It didn't free me immediately, but it redirected my goals.
Mm-hmm. So how did your parents feel about your decision?
What I started to do, I think by the time that I was practicing law, so that was in 95, was that I was actually very clear with my mother and father that it was not something that the profession was not what I wanted out of life. That, like I've just said to you, that it was brutal. It was brutal, and it brought nothing to me except a lot of grief. And I think that that was sort of the necessary groundwork. I didn't spring it on them all at once, is what I'm trying to say, that I shared with them how unhappy it was making me. So, by the time I decided to leave the law, I also should say that by the time I left the law, I had a book contract. So at least, for them, it felt like, she has a temporary income stream, I think one of the very I think it's very difficult for my parents, many refugee parents, to sort of wrap their heads around the instability of the arts, as a profession. And that, I think, is something that I try to tell and share with students and younger folks who tell me that their parents are dead set upon, on them going into the arts, is try to remember that for the parents, it's not necessarily about amassing this huge wealth, or it's really about a sense of stability, and how they want that for their children. And it comes out of fear, and wanting to keep their children safe. I do not believe, at least with refugees' parents, that it comes out of greed. It's not about how large your house is, how fancy your car is. It's about a sense of stability, and that's what they want for you. And it is, it requires you to remind them in turn that part of the reason, right, that they came to the United States was so that you would have an opportunity to live a full life. And part of living a full life is joy and happiness. And to share with them what it means to you to be able to practice whatever, you know, discipline it is that you're interested in, writing, dancing, acting, directing, whatever it may be, to really try to communicate to your parents the full sort of joy of it for you. And they may still not be happy, but I think they'll be more willing to accept your decisions.
Mm-hmm. So have you mentored a lot of students in this way?
I have taught on the college level. It's not a, it's not part of my yearly sort of life. I've taught three times, twice on the undergraduate level, once at Princeton, one at Baruch College, which is part of the City University of New York. And most recently, I taught at Columbia in the MFA program. And also, in terms of mentoring, yes, in those classes, I always have students, mainly Asian American students who see me and see me as an example of a career path that they would like to pursue. And they reach out to me and they tell me about how their parents want them to go to law school. And, you know, but I also have students from other immigrant backgrounds who, you know, feel the same set of constraints from their parents. So yes, I've mentored students in that way. I've also mentored students through, not my students, but young folks from, you know, who are involved in the Asian American Writers Workshop in another Asian American literary arts organization that's called Kundiman, that's here in New York. So, yes, I kind of feel that is part of my responsibility as a literary citizen, you know, and as an Asian American to at least listen, you know. I can't always help them, you know, beyond that, but I think it is really important to have, one, an example, and two, someone who's willing to hear your trials and tribulations, you know? But I have to tell you that one of the most meaningful sort of mentorship I have been involved in is of he was a Chinese American student at Princeton. His parents wanted him to go to law school very, very badly. He wanted to go to graphic design school, you know. And in this instance, I was able to help him. And the way that I did it was that he needed a way to pay for his graduate work in graphic design. And he was applying for a number of very prestigious, difficult to receive scholarships. And I felt that, you know, my understanding of what it's like for someone in his position allowed me to write a letter that was very persuasive. And he got one of those scholarships. It was a Soros fellowship. And now he co-owns his own graphic design firm in Brooklyn. And it was, that made me feel like I could really, that there was a purpose for me being in the classroom. If it was, you know, simply just to help him find the means to pay for his schooling.
So have you had any mentors for yourself throughout your career?
I have. And it was really through the Asian American Writers Workshop that I met Asian American women writers who were just really, this is how I know how important it is just simply to see an example of what's possible, you know? And one of them is, you know, Jessica Hagedorn, who's Filipina American. And she lives in New York. I read her before I ever met her. And now I consider her a friend. And I have gone back to her time and time again, not only, you know, for things like recommendation letters, you know, but for simply like for the publishing world is small, and it's also difficult to navigate, you know, and you need someone who's gone through it to be able to say to you, you know, this is what your publicist should be doing for you. This is what your editor needs to be doing for you. This is what your agent should be doing for you. And it's writers like Jessica who have really given me that kind of knowledge, right? Yeah.
So can you describe the process of writing your first book? How was that for you?
Sure. Well, I started it, like I said, as a short story written while I was still practicing law. And then it took from that point 5 years until it came out. And it's because I wasn't able to write full time immediately. I would apply for fellowships that would, you know, allow me to have enough to live for and to pay my loans for maybe 1 or 2 months, and I would, you know, try to get a leave of absence from my law firm in order to do that, which I did. And I would quit my job at law firms. And before I started at the new one, I would use that gap to work on the book. But that first novel in many ways was entirely unexpected, you know, unexpected in terms of the fact that one, anyone that a publishing house purchased it, that it came out and became a bestseller, that it won awards, and I think more importantly to me that it continues to be taught on the college level mainly, you know. But I think, you know, if generally sort of speaking more on in terms of writerly terms, what I have come to understand about the first novel is, you know, you save up everything that you've ever wanted to say and it goes into that first novel, right? And there is sort of a kind of almost a magical experience with it, because the voice for it came to me very fully formed, and it's almost like I heard the voice, you know. I also have come to understand that the way that the publishing industry works, they love the first novel, they love the debut novelist, you know. So, and I think perhaps because I given my biography, that I am a Vietnamese American, a former refugee, perhaps the publishing industry and then also then the press didn't expect what was in that novel, you know, that wasn't situated in the context of the Vietnam War. And I think that gave it a certain distinction and made it stand out at that time. And I didn't do that because I didn't think that there was something to be said about the Vietnam War or the refugee experience. I did it more so because the subject matter really appealed to me, which is the live-in cook for Gertrude Stein and Alice B. Toklas, a young gay Vietnamese man living in Paris in the late 20s, early 30s. I love cooking, I love to eat, I love writing about what all of that can mean to a person. So that was exciting to me. And then I also, I think, really wanted this kind of I wanted my first foray into writing a novel to really kind of remind readers that the Vietnam War doesn't define Vietnam, that our history is far longer and far more complicated, and we have dealt with colonizers from many countries, you know, and that appealed to me too, you know, so yeah.
So you said the main character is a gay man. Do you have a connection to the gay community?
Besides the fact that I grew up with many LGBTQ friends, no, you know, I am not LGBTQ identified. This is part of the what I was saying about how that voice came to me fully formed. I should back up and just say that Alice B. Toklas, who was Gertrude Stein's lover for many years, wrote a cookbook and it was called the Alice B. Toklas Cookbook. And in it, there's a chapter that's called Servants in France. And she writes about, quote unquote, Indo-Chinese men who worked for them as live-in cooks. And that's, so that's, that was the seed, right, for me. Did she mention that these men were gay, straight? No. But when I sat down and I thought about the character, that's how the character came to me as a gay man. It's one of these decisions that, looking back, I can't believe that I just went with it. You know, that I said, oh, okay, fine. I'm going to write in the first person voice of a gay man. But I did. Possibly because I actually didn't go to an MFA program, you know? I think I would have been more scared to do it, you know, because through the workshopping process, now that I've seen it firsthand on the other side, you know, as the instructor, when you have, I mean, pun intended, so many cooks, right? Mm-hmm. You know, getting all of these feedback from other people, I think that would have really, and I think certainly some of that feedback would have been, how dare you? Can you do it? Why are you doing this? You know, all the things that I, you know, yeah, you should ask, you know, but when you're writing it, I don't think you should ask it yet, right? Before you publish it, yes, you're going to ask those questions of yourself. And you're going to have a response, because readers will ask, you know, and they still do. Like, why did you write in the voice of a gay man? And I always give them a two-part answer. One is what I've told you, which is that's how the voice came to me, along with his sense of humor, his, you know, everything about him came to me fully formed. The second part of that answer is, as I was working on that novel, it became clear to me that, thank goodness, he came to me as a gay man. And just, you know, briefly, if I had made that character a straight man, working within the household of, within a lesbian household, there would have to be a scene where he recognizes the love between the two women. As a straight man, he would react to it. And how would he react to it, given the fact of the era, you know, his culture, his, you know, his country of origin, all of that? It would, I think, undoubtedly have been a moment of shock, you know, a moment of, what is this that I'm witnessing? You know, I didn't have to write that scene, because that's not how my character reacted to the love between these two women. He recognized it as being part of his identity, you know. And it allowed me to, I think, to write a more complicated, complex novel without that scene of shock, you know, and a scene of recognition instead.
Mm-hmm. So do you have a writing process, like a time or place?
Yeah, it has changed over the years. Most recently, I had been writing at a shared sort of writer's studio that's part of the Center for Fiction, which is in Brooklyn, around a 40-minute walk from where I live. And I mentioned the walk because that is really part of the process, you know, because I do think that there has to be a transition process between your everyday life and your everyday being, right? The person who cleans the kitchen, cleans the bathroom, cooks her meals, that sort of thing. And the person who is the creator, the writer, the imaginative person. That person operates and thinks differently. They have to. And so that walk was always that transition where I would put on my headphones, I would listen to music, and it was almost like a kind of a walking kind of meditation, you know, that brought me to this writing space. Before I was writing there, I had a different writing space nearby, which was in a very large shared loft as well, with other women, only women. And that was a fantastic writing space. It's called Powder Keg. Mira Jacobs wrote there, Susan Choi, you know, other Asian Americans, not only Asian Americans, but all sorts of Brooklyn women. I often tell young writers as well that they need to have a dedicated space, you know, the room of one's own, basically. And that's a very hard thing to do in the city of New York, to have a dedicated space, you know? So that has, you know, been my most recent process. Before then, my dedicated space was often to travel to other places to write, most often to an artist residency somewhere. And it would be a very concentrated amount of time. Often a month can be as long as, you know, almost 3 months. Again, it's that kind of transition and also disconnect from what I consider my everyday life and my creative life. Yeah.
So where do you find inspiration for your writing?
Well, all the novels are different. But certainly the first novel, The Book of Salt, is, and the most recent novel, The Sweetest Fruits, they're historical novels, right? So the seeds for them come from history. But I think that it begins with a question. It begins with me reading something that seems to be not fully documented, not fully there in what, you know, in the archives, right? So let's say with the Book of Salt, Alice Toklas wrote very briefly about these men, you know, but she wrote very evocatively of them. And I wanted to know how they got there. What did they see in that household, you know? And that kind of question is what begins the process. And usually then it is followed by research, attempting to answer that in what has been documented, you know? And what I tend to focus on the narratives or on the characters, on the sliver of history that has very few documented resources. And then I try to fill in, the spaces between the facts. And I think hopefully it should be clear that the reason why these stories, like of a laborer, a young man who comes to Paris, the reason why he's not documented is because he couldn't leave. There were no letters, perhaps, that were left behind. No one thought he was relevant in history. He, except that he happened to have worked for one of the most iconic American couples living in Paris at the time, literary names. And he was just mentioned in passing, but there's so much more. That pattern has certainly is in place for my most recent novel, which is called The Sweetest Fruits. And it's about the women who are they exist in the periphery of a very well-known, very well-documented writer named Lafcadio Hearn, who lived from 1850 to 1904. But the women around his life were not as well documented. They were often dismissed by his biographers as being illiterate. These were his wives. He had two wives. I write in their voices. His mother. I wanted to think about them and think about them in a way that gave them agency, that didn't dismiss them outright.
Mm-hmm. So do you think this concept of telling undocumented people's stories, do you think it's like a common thread in your writing?
Yeah, certainly. It's a process that's very much about reclaiming these voices. I think but of course it's a process that can really can only often be achieved through fiction, because if I was a historian, there would be no way for me to, I would be necessarily reliant on what is in the archives, but if you're writing, as in my case, about, let's say, the first wife of Lafcadio Hearn, she was an African-American woman. She was born into slavery. She was did not have access to the written word. She could not leave letters behind the way that he did. She could not leave a diary. The only representation of her voice that I had was from a newspaper article that Hearn wrote about her. Didn't even identify her by name, but spoke about her as being a very good storyteller, and that she was a ghost seer, you know, and how she would tell these incredibly atmospheric stories. And he wrote it in her voice, you know, or in his kind of take on her voice. And I mention her because she's an example of someone who was written out of his biography and therefore history altogether. His first biographer refused to acknowledge that he had a relationship or a marriage with someone named Alethea Foley, even though she knew. His first biographer was a woman, a white woman. And she wrote out Alethea. And for years after that, other biographers wrote Alethea out of history. So yes, I do feel like I am, my project is to reach back and say, I want to hear your story, Alethea, you know? And why I produce this fiction, I can't give you Alethea, you know? But this is what we have. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So do you think that your identity, your personal identity, is reflected in your writing as well?
Oh, absolutely. Everything I write is through the lens of, through an Asian American lens, through a refugee lens. So even when I write a book, like the most recent one, that has no Vietnamese or Vietnamese American character in it, I consider it very much a Vietnamese American work and very much an Asian American work. Because those experiences have shaped me, have shaped my everything about me. And with that said, though, let's acknowledge that American publishing is still hesitant, you know, I don't know if the word is hesitant. Maybe the word is they don't know what to do with works like mine. When I first had the idea for this novel, maybe, gosh, almost 10 years ago, my literary agent at that time said to me that she wouldn't be able to sell it because I didn't have a Vietnamese or a Vietnamese American character in it. She said, no one's going to buy it. And yeah, and it's out in the world. Someone did buy it. but really, you know, if your project, if your goal in life is to sell books, you probably wouldn't have wanted to write the book I wrote and try to find readers for it in this moment in time. Because it doesn't speak to, how do I put it? There has been the idea of voices, literary voices, quote unquote, staying within their lanes. You know what that means, right? Which means write about your own experience. Write about your own race or ethnicity. It's that kind of setting, that kind of drawing borders within our imagination. I cannot get behind that project. I think it's, with that said, it's not the same as me saying you have the right to write anything you'd like and not take responsibility for it, because it's a work of the imagination or it's a work of fiction. Of course, words matter, representation matter, narrative matters, and some are incredibly hurtful and racist and just simply poorly written. But that's the risk you take as a writer. You know, if you're an artist and you're writing, you're always going to take the risk of just being not the risk of failure, right? You're gonna fail in many ways, but I can never get behind the advice or the point of view that there are lanes for your creativity.
So do you think that being labeled as an Asian American writer, like, what are the specific expectations that are placed on you, I guess?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I think that it depends on who you're talking about. Let's talk about, let's say, your community. You know, I do think that there is a certain expectation that, and there is a certain expectation that you will write something that is in some way representative of the experiences of your community, you know. So the Bitter in the Mouth had to do with a, you know, Vietnamese American child, but you don't really get that until the middle of the book. So I think you know, let me back up and say this. Okay. I fully understand when, as readers, let's say you're a Vietnamese American reader and you are hungry to see a representation of yourself or your family or people you know in a work of literature, and you open up a book by a Vietnamese American author, and it seems, for example, with the second novel, Bitter in the Mouth, it seems to be set in the American South in the mid 70s within the household of a white family. It might startle you, surprise you, shock you, that what is she doing? What is this? You know, why isn't, you know, this character, Linda Hamrick, why is she not Vietnamese American? Or why is there not a Vietnamese American family in this? And part of my project, especially with that book, was to ask of every single reader to question their definition of what makes a family. You know, that families can be constructed from adopted children, from, you know, people of different races and ethnicity. But if you go into that book and the first half and you expect, you know, that a family in the South with a child named Linda Hamrick is necessarily a white family, you'll be wrong. Because by the middle of the book, you find out that she was adopted from Vietnam. But I'll tell you that that book was extremely hard to for the publishers, and I think, you know, to sort of explain or market to people, because readers, whether they're Vietnamese Americans, Asian Americans or not, have certain expectations of what an Asian American narrative is, you know, and what an Asian American writer will write about. And the American South is not one of them, you know. A book where the character is not immediately identified as a Vietnamese refugee is not one of them. You know, I say this, and it's also clear that I have three novels to my name. They've been published by, you know, large mainstream publishers. You know, so it's not necessarily a closed gate, right? You can get past that gate. You can reach your readers, but it's incredibly difficult. And what I've told you so far is only part of the publishing history of these books. It's not a straight line. There's a lot of battles that I've had to fight along the way in order to get these books out in the way that I wanted them to emerge into the world, and not to be re-edited or to expand upon things that my editors thought would, you know, grab readers more, or, you know, and so on, right? So yes, there are always expectations. But again, it depends on what you want, what kind of writer you want to be. If you want to sell a lot of books, then you listen to the expectations and you write a work that can address, you know, the needs of the majority of your readers. I don't know how to do that.
So what impact do you think your writing has had on your audience, and have you been able to talk to them about that?
You know, earlier I mentioned sort of my surprise at the fact that the Book of Salt continues to be read and taught in a classroom setting. And I can say that also about Bitter in the Mouth. And I'm hoping that'll be the case with the third novel as well. It's already been taught this semester in a number of different classes because, you know, the professors have reached out to me to let me know, invite me to speak to the class and so on. To me, that connection, that sort of that impact on academia that my books have had is the highest honor. Because I remember very clearly what it was like to sit in a classroom at Yale and talk about the work of Toni Morrison, Alice Walker, Maxine Hong Kingston, and really engage in the themes and just how meaningful they were on all sorts of level for a young student. You know, often it's the first time you've seen, you know, you've read a work by, you know, hopefully now in college, it's not the first time that you've read a work by an Asian American author or an African American author. But for me, reading Maxine Hong Kingston was the first time I'd read an Asian American novel, you know, or short story or anything. Yeah, so I know from the many, many times that I've visited classrooms and universities that the work allows the professors to really explore the themes that are important to me about home, about identity, about history, about who is included in history, who is excluded. I could go on. I mean, one of the things that I'm proudest of is the fact that that the Book of Salt was taught in a labor studies class at UC Santa Cruz, you know, because that's exactly one of the themes that I was trying to explore about whose labor is celebrated and whose is ignored, you know, and devalued. And the fact that someone, you know, has not only picked up on it, but has included it in their syllabus and students are considering it is a huge, I don't know, it feels like I'm doing something that matters, you know, continuing a dialogue.
So do you think that's the most rewarding thing about being a writer for you?
Yeah, I actually do think so. Because I'll tell you that the writing itself is rarely joyful. Even though I said, you know, earlier on that, you know, the reason why I wanted to be a writer was to find that joy that I was seeing in other people at the Asian American Writers Workshop. And the writing is not joyful because it's unearthing a lot of very painful, you know, emotions and feelings, right? But the writing isn't joyful, but the after the writing is joyful. You know, the ability then to go out into the world with a work that you're proud of and to share it with other people. And then to have, you know, people contact me from so many places in the world, because that book has been translated into multiple languages. To reach out to me and say what it means to them. You know, it's you know that a work has to really touch you for you to sort of kind of search out the author's email and send them a note. You know, you're too busy in life most of the time. You have other things. You have so much other things. And in that way, it really does feel like these works are out there kind of as my little avatars in the world, and they make friends. And that's amazing to me. It really is. And definitely in that classroom setting, it means that there's a conversation going on. It's not about, oh, people are reading my book, you know, because I'm such a great writer, you know. It's about being part of the dialogue, about it's about being part of that American tradition of creativity and pushing the boundaries of narrative, you know, and pushing the boundaries of language. And, you know, American literature is incredibly vibrant. And it's vibrant because of the continual influx of people who come to the English language, who come to the United States, who bring personal history, as well as history with a capital H, you know, but really it feels like you're a part of this larger enterprise, this larger community. And yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think that your writing has been able to resonate with these people?
I think because of the themes that interest me, you know. I think so many people, but in particular, you know, readers of color can really wrap their heads around this notion of how fragile home is. You know, whether in the United States or anywhere, and how it is one of the ways that I construct home for myself and for my characters is rarely having to do with a place, a land. It's more about the community of people that is around you. And I think that resonates, that because in an odd way, that's actually very hopeful. You know, the idea that you can be at home almost anywhere if you have a hand to hold, a shoulder, but, you know, to put your head on, an ear to listen to your stories. That's how home is constructed in my narratives. You know, I think that's a, you know, but I think that probably the folks who are better, better suited to answer your questions are the academics who, you know, find a lot to talk about and to deal with respect to my novels. But I tell the stories that interests me. You know, I think sometimes I'll get the question of who do you write for, you know, and it might sound selfish, but I don't think of it as being selfish. I write for myself, first of all, because it's really, goes back to the idea that for me, a novel begins with a question. So it's my attempt to answer the question and other questions that arise during the process of writing it. And I spend a lot of time, you know, I'm not a fast writer. I think through these things. And sometimes I don't have answers, and I don't really write my novels so that you, the reader, will come out with a set of answers too. It's really more it's about creating a narrative that has enough room within it for you to enter in it, to imagine the possible answers. You know, answer it for yourself.
So can you talk about Bitter in the Mouth and kind of how much does the book stem from your own identity and your experiences?
Right. So Bitter in the Mouth was my second novel, and it's set in the little town where my family and I first lived after we left the relocation camps, and it's called Boiling Springs, North Carolina. And, you know, I'm not a Vietnamese adoptee, but I made my main character a Vietnamese adoptee. And I think I've already talked about that idea of questioning what it means to be a family, right? And how we define a family. With that novel, there were a couple of very important things going on for me as the writer. One was that I began with the idea of a neurological condition that's called synesthesia, which is the mixing of the senses. And my main character has a form where when she speaks or says certain words, they trigger a flavor for her. And so that is not, clearly, that's not something taken from some sort of historical sort of, you know, footnote or anything like that. This is a neurological condition that's still still being researched and is being, you know, not fully understood yet. But the reason why I wanted to write a character that had that condition was that I wanted her to have a very profound difference that was not detectable on the outside. Her difference was an interior one. one that she could hide. And it also allowed me to write again about food and flavors, but not in the same way as a first person narrator who's a cook would write about it. A very different take on flavors. And that novel is, it begins where Linda is, you know, her name is Linda. She's telling you about her small town, her condition. She's introducing herself to you, the reader, you know? But what you realize by the middle of the book is that she is introducing you to only part of her. And because I'm a writer and the story is not a visual story, she could hide. You know, it's her voice, and she can share with you the details that she wants to share about herself. And by the middle of the book, you understand that she is an adoptee, that there is this additional layer of difference that sets her apart from her family and her community. And that would have been the thing that you would have noted first about her if you met her in life. If I was telling a visual story, it would be the primary sort of marker of difference on her is that she is Asian. So it was very much a narrative that was exploring what I thought of as the unreliable reader. Okay, you've heard of the unreliable narrator, right? Which is the narrator who lies, tells falsehoods, you know, is telling a story that, is in fact untrue. With Linda, she doesn't really tell you, I'm not Asian American, I'm not an adoptee. She just never said those things. And given the context, given her family, and the fact that you understand that the family is white and that the context is a small town in the South, you, the reader, fill in the rest, you know, based on your idea of the world, your understanding of the world. And I was relying on the fact that readers would assume that she is also white. And what I wanted was to sort of test that notion. What happens once you do learn that she is Asian American, a Vietnamese adoptee? Do you understand her differently? Do you understand her family differently? Or is she, how she presented herself to be in the very beginning. So the interesting thing about that novel, and I've alluded to it, that it was that the publisher didn't know what to do with it. And the reviewers didn't know what to do with it because I've basically given away, right? the mystery, the surprise in the middle of that book, right? Reviewers, almost every one of them did the same, that they gave it away as if it didn't matter, that they needed to convince readers to read the book, that I actually wasn't writing about a white family or a white character, that I was in fact writing about a character that I had more of a personal connection to, you know? So there was a real word isn't hesitancy. The word, it's almost a kind of anxiety that that book produced for the publisher and the reviewers. I used all of my experiences growing up, all of the pain, all of the anger I had towards that community in the writing of that book. But it actually was it cathartic? Maybe not cathartic, but it allowed me time to spend with that community again, like a kind of revisiting in my mind. And it, I don't know if it lessened the anger, but I think it allowed me to take more of control over those memories, because what was happening was that I was revisiting. I mean, I literally revisited Boiling Springs in the writing of the book, but also, of course, figuratively, I was revisiting it for, it took, I think with that one, was a 7-year-long process. I was revisiting it as an adult, you know, someone who had agency, someone who was not dependent on my parents or that, or my teachers. I felt like I, because I was, you know, someone who had control over my life, which is very different than how I was when I was there as a child, you know? So in that sense, it allowed me to really kind of look at that community and look at the characters that I was creating, and I think to write something that was more fully fleshed out and not just a cardboard figure of evil or bullies, or, you know, it was a more considered work of fiction.
Mm-hmm. So can you also talk briefly about Sweetest Fruits and what your research process was like for that book?
Sure. The Sweetest Fruits, the question that started the Sweetest Fruits was basically, I love to collect cookbooks. I like old cookbooks. I love like very niche cookbooks. And I read a cookbook by Lafcadio O'Hearn, again, who lived from 1850 to 1904. And it was called The Creole Cookbook, La Cuisine Creole, right? And it was published in 1885. And it was considered the very first cookbook to be published about Creole cuisine in the United States. Even though the title is La Cuisine Creole, it's in English. And I had heard of Lafcadio O'Hearn, but I knew very little about him, but everything that I heard, that I had read about him, didn't make sense to me. That he was half Irish, half Greek. He came to the US as a young man. He lived in Cincinnati, he lived in New Orleans. Obviously there he published this cookbook. And then at the age of 40, he moved to Japan and became known as a Western expert on Japanese folklore, fairy tales, and ghost stories. That's quite a lot of the world that he covered, right? But as with many things, I began the project with some sort of food or flavor element. So he's written many, many books, but I began there. And La Cuisine Creole is a book that is absurd. it's a cookbook that is I could tell was written by someone who had a limited knowledge of food, had a lot of interest in food, but didn't quite really know much about it, and was very arrogant. You know, his introduction was just awful. It was something about how, you know, it was about how men are more scientifically minded, and so they were better cooks, and so therefore they got paid more to cook than women. I mean, it was filled with that kind of assertions, which perhaps is not surprising at all given the era, right? But I didn't know how that man went on to become the expert in Japan. You know, like what tied him, you know, from one place to the other. And so I started doing the research for it. And there are lots and lots of biographies about him. And they would mention his mother. They mentioned his first wife, who, as I said, is an African-American woman. She's biracial. She was born into slavery on a farm in Kentucky. And he met her in Ohio post-Civil War. She was a cook in the boarding house where he worked. Already, I was starting to answer some of my questions, right? Perhaps she was the one who got him interested in sort of the minutiae of food and food preparation. You know, I'm an avid cook. I know my husband knows quite a lot about cooking just because he's married to me. Do you know what I mean? So I was thinking, okay, maybe that's the connection there, right? And then how about Japan? In the biographies, it became clear that he married again while he was in Japan to a woman who was described as being the daughter of a former samurai who was illiterate in English. And supposedly they did not have a language in common because Hearn did not have Japanese. It took me a very long time, a lot of research to pin down the fact that he was never fluent in Japanese, that he relied on interpreters the entire time that he lived there, last 14 years of his life, right? I mean, that's not surprising. And I don't fault a person for not, you know, learning the language and having fluency in it. It's the fact that the biographers tried to obfuscate, you know, to write around it as much as possible, while emphasizing the fact that his Japanese wife had no English, right? And they often talked about how he came up with a language for them, which was sort of a simplified English, simplified Japanese, right? And it was their private language. Well, I love the idea of a private language, but I also know, having been married for so long, and anyone who's been in a long-term relationship knows that it's not a language, a form of communication between the two parties. It's not a one-sided endeavor. It's created, it's co-created, you know? So already I had an idea of this woman that did not comport with the history, you know, with the biographers. And so I needed to know more. I needed to know more about her. I traveled first to Lefkada, the island where Lafcadio's mother met his Irish father. Then I traveled to Japan on a fellowship. And it wasn't until I got to Japan and to the town where they met, which is called Matsue, which is on the western coast of Japan, where there is a museum devoted to him, that things finally became clear, because they were literally written on the wall. I too have no Japanese, but there was an exhibit. It was there was English, and it talked about how his wife had worked in his household as a maid. That's how they met, and that she was married to a Japanese man previous to meeting Lafcadio, but that the man had left her. So already all these things were like coming together. Like, you understand that this is a woman who was not simply the daughter of a former samurai, which seems to give her this elevated status, right? She was a woman who essentially has been abandoned by a first husband, is impoverished, is working as a servant for Lafcadio. And then the story it required so much piecing together of the facts that were in existence about her, that she wasn't illiterate in Japanese, right? She wasn't. She had the equivalent, I think it was of like an eighth grade education. So she could read and write in Japanese. She served as his interpreter. She also told him many of the ghost stories and the fairy tales and the folklore that he then was able to rewrite in English and make his name as an expert, you know. So if I had sat at home here in Brooklyn and depended on the biographers, even the more recent ones, I would have been left with this idea that he married this, you know, formerly high-born woman who was presented as someone who was docile and simply, you know, was the mother of his children. It was such a flawed and fragmented, you know, and fragmentary history of her. And one of the other things that I was able to find when I went to Matsue was that there was a history that was written about her in particular by a Japanese author. And he translated his own work into English. And I was able to find that work. And finally, there was a book that was focused on her and not on Hearn. And it answered so many questions, right? But still, there were huge gaps in between the facts. And that's where I worked, in those gaps. So the research took me also around the world, which was great. I love to travel. And it made me like her more too by the end, because I suppose I wrote a narrative where Hearn was much more of a relatable character a person who's flawed. I think his biographers were always very clear that he was a flawed human being, but they weren't clear, or they didn't have the documentation to fill in how it is this flawed human being was actually assisted and found strength with the women who were an integral part of his life.
Mm-hmm. So are you currently working on anything?
I am. Since 2013, maybe, I've been working with composers, working on, I've written, sort of standalone songs, I've written choral works, I've written song cycles, and I'm in the process of writing a libretto for an opera that will be based, or rather, let's say, inspired by the life of Virginia Woolf and the American artist Joseph Cornell. And I'm working on that project with a composer named Joan LaBarbera. And most recently, I worked with a, or we're still in the process of working on a multimedia piece for a chamber ensemble for that for a composer named Xuhui Chen, and she teaches at Rice at the Shepherd School Music, and it's a commission that, you know, well, if things go back to some form of normal, will be premiered at the Asia Society in Houston at the end of 2021 or the beginning of 2022. Yeah. So it's for her, I'm writing a narration. So it's not going to be, you know, it will be spoken by an actor. But it's been a really, I have to say that this is finally an instance where writing is a joy, which is, you know, I can't really explain it besides the fact that it just, one, it's a faster process to write lyrics. It flows as it should, I suppose. And I love the process of working, of collaborating with a composer, and with Xuhui Chen, we are also working with a director slash scenic designer. So, you know, it's very much a collaboration. And it feels very alive and exciting relative to the way that I usually work, it's very fast.
So what direction do you see your writing going in the future?
I don't know. I really don't know. I hope to write another novel. I have an idea for another novel. It's not a historical novel. It's a work of speculative fiction set in the near future. But it's also it's going to revisit some themes that are near and dear to me, which is food, in a very, very different way. But at this point, I don't know, because as you've noted, the date of our interview, we're living in incredibly uncertain, unstable times. I find it very, very difficult to focus on a long-term project. I'm really feeling like I need a reserve of hope and faith, which I'm running very low on. So I don't know whether there's another novel or not.
So there's a quote on your website that says, "The only thing that she really likes to exercise is her right to vote, and she hopes that her fellow Americans will make a better, kinder, more intelligent decision in 2020. Mm. Can you talk more about your viewpoint on that?
And what you mean on that? Yeah, I mean, that was clearly my exhortation to anyone that comes across my webpage to not vote for, to re-elect President Trump. I consider I am a highly political person, and I consider all my writing to be political as well. It might not be didactic, but all three of my novels are political, as well as my essays. I'll tell you that it's one of the most disappointing things about the past few years is to see the incredible lack of empathy. From President Trump himself and his administration, but also the people who are his supporters. The lack of empathy, the tremendous amount of self-centeredness, selfishness, and the active resistance to history, their own personal history, as well as the history of the United States. If you are an American today and you can open up your mouth and say that there is no systemic racism, you're lying to yourself. You're lying to yourself, and you're lying to in the face of documented facts, you know? And I want to say something about the Vietnamese American community. I've read articles that talk about how there have been polls that have been cited that somewhere around 48% of Vietnamese Americans will be voting or have voted for Trump. That to me is incredibly disappointing. How can it be that a community who came to the US as refugees, who asked this nation to open their doors to us, how can we close the doors to other people? I don't understand it, but I could ask that same question of every single person whose family came here as immigrants. And that's the vast number of people, except for, you know, Native Americans and Black Americans who were brought here as enslaved people. I just don't understand it. And it's very painful. And I think that that is part of the drain on the reserve of hope and faith that these past few years have taken, you know, from me. I know that there are writers and other creatives who can draw upon these moments of strife and these moments of unrest and really create and respond to it. Clearly I have my feelings. I'm able to express them, but it takes me so long to process some of this, which is that I maybe in a decade or two, that's when I can take what I'm experiencing now and feeling now and turn that into somehow a work, a novel, so short stories, something, but not yet. I still have to process it. And really, I know that for Vietnamese Americans, there was the sense, there is still the sense that that Trump is a strong leader, a leader that will keep communism at bay, and that somehow Joe Biden and his administration is opening the doors to socialism. And that is what is triggering a lot of the fears and a lot of the knee-jerk reaction. But I think in addition to that, if we are truly going to be honest with one another, a lot of it is also anti-Blackness. It's racism. And and that is incredibly disappointing to me, because I take so much strength from African American literature, from my fellow African American writers. I don't know what to say, except that it's deeply painful and disappointing.
Do you think there are ways that we can address the anti-Black sentiment in the Asian American community? Do you see ways to improve that?
I think part of it is, if you came here as an adult, so I'm limiting my answer here to, let's say, folks like Vietnamese Americans who came here as refugees. Mm-hmm. You may have never learned the history of the United States, really. I mean, and in lieu of learning the history of how the United States, excuse me, in lieu of learning that history, what you're getting instead from popular media, from society at large, is this message, this incredible anti-Black message, that here is a community of people who are, you know, welfare cheats, lazy. I mean, we don't have to go into all of the, you know, the stereotypes. But it's very much, I think, a message that is meant to instruct newcomers, like a refugee community, don't be like them. You know, and if you do some of these things, you're like them, and they are not respected, not full citizens, and deserve the kind of treatment that they get, right? So it's, perhaps that's it, is that what some folks, some Vietnamese Americans who came here as refugees learned was that, you know. But why I think the moment that you're able to learn the history of how systemic the inequalities are and how it was built in to this country from the days of enslavement to post-Civil War to the Jim Crow era to, I cannot imagine that if folks really had a time to sort of just learn some of the history of Black Americans, that there would not be more of an understanding and ability to empathize with what is going on in the United States. So maybe I think this is why I don't know. I'm trying to think through if this is why I am constantly going back to history as the seed for my own work. I don't know. But I think to answer your question about maybe if we open up that question, or I try to open up the question to Asian Americans and racism within the communities, I don't think, you know, Chinese Americans and Japanese Americans, communities who have had generations in the United States, not always, but certainly there are segments who have been here for so long. I don't think that there is that kind of pervasive anti-Blackness. How could you be a Japanese American and know your own history of being interned, you know, forced into camps, labeled an enemy, and based on your identity? How could you turn around and look at your fellow Americans who are Black, how could you turn around and look at them and not see the similarities, the connective tissues between the two groups. And I think with perhaps the next generation, the younger generation right now, like yourself, those kind of bridges, those kind of connective tissues will grow stronger, will develop. I don't know. I think the worst thing that could happen is this idea that somehow Asian Americans, refugee origins or not, the worst thing that can happen, I think, is if they think of themselves as honorary whites, as somehow that tent is going to open up and they could enter into it. Because America does have a history of that. We, the nation, make honorary white folks. And I'll give you an example, Italians and Irish. There was a time when an Italian was not a white person. An Irish person was not considered, you know, good enough to walk into the front door of a shop, you know. But eventually what we needed was more white people. And if Asian Americans think that this is how we will, you know, persevere or become part of the national fabric is to be these honorary whites, I think we will be disgraceful. We will be a disgraceful community.
So, do you think that you have always been comfortable with your Vietnamese identity or proud of it?
Well, I'm very proud to be Vietnamese American. But I, you know, it's it might be a little bit difficult to kind of wrap your head around when you're sort of in a state like Texas, right? Where there is, and especially in a city like Houston, where there's a sizable Asian American community, you know, folks have an understanding of Korean Americans versus Chinese Americans versus Taiwanese Americans versus Vietnamese, Cambodian, Lao, you know. I have lived in places in the US as a child and as an adult where there's not that understanding of difference or the need to understand. We're just generally Asian American, right? And in a way, I've come to understand that is my main identity as Asian American. It's a constructed identity, right? We constructed it here in the US for political purposes. Asian, you know, that concept actually doesn't really exist anywhere else. You know, people are their own country, you know, their own nationality. They're not this vast continent of Asia, you know. In the US, because there were few of us, we came together and became Asian American, you know, for a political voice, for strength. So when I'm And I see that I veer more, in addition to being Asian American, I veer towards being a person of color, you know? And I find strength, solidarity, and example from Black community, from the Latinx community, from the LGBTQ communities, you know? So to me, that's what I'm really proud of, is the ability of these communities to come together and find strength with one another, you know, to find common ground. You know, and I, among Vietnamese Americans, there are incredibly progressive, active, you know, members, younger folks often. And I'm tremendously proud to call those folks my community. So I don't think my identity is, you know, my identity and my community is not defined by the fact that all these folks are Vietnamese or all these folks are Asian. It's really more of their ethos and their social justice ethos in particular. One that is inclusive, one that is striving to lift up, you know, other folks, no matter the color of their skin, you know, or where they came from. That to me is what I'm proud of. So does that make sense to you? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So have you visited Vietnam?
I have. I've only been back twice.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first time was maybe in 2007, and the second time was maybe, I'm gonna say 2013, maybe. Mm-hmm. I think one of the reasons why it took me so long to go back was that I really wanted to go back with my mother. And my mother never wanted to go back. until she did. And so we traveled together, my younger sister, myself, my husband, my mother, by 2007, enough of especially younger people in America had, you know, traveled to Vietnam or even lived there, you know. And so before I went back, there was always a lot of, you know, kind of chit chat at parties about how great going to Vietnam was for them, how cheap it was, how, you know, people were so friendly. And I knew that when we went back, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a vacation for us. It was going to be a reckoning, you know, with something that we had left behind, trying to do what? Who knew what was going to happen? And there was so much sadness. So much sadness, not just simply because of a sense of what we had lost, but I think the sadness may have and situated in the idea of the other lives that we could have lived, you know, like, like my mother walking around Saigon, which is no longer called Saigon, of course, and pointing out things that, you know, didn't exist anymore. You know, the bookstore that my grandfather owned was now a hotel. It wasn't even the same building, but it was kind of there. Like we saw it. It was like this ghostly scrim of a thing. And she saw it. We didn't. And then on and on. It was just so much sadness. I think what I found, and I think a lot of my friends who are Vietnamese Americans around my age who go back, is often, you know, what the first thing that hits you is that no one thinks of you as Vietnamese. They can tell right away by your clothing, by your Vietnamese and how it doesn't quite sound Vietnamese maybe, or your, you know, and with me, it was about the, you know, just the body, that my body didn't look like a Vietnamese woman's body anymore. I was an Asian American, you know, I was a bigger person than those around me. And then, so it's kind of a, you know, you live in the US with this sort of fantasy that there's this different place, this other country where you may belong and that you would belong. But then when you get there and then you understand that you don't belong there, then what do you have? You don't have the fantasy. And then you have the country that you go back to and people look at you and assume you don't speak English, you know, or that you know, you're a visitor, or it's incredibly painful. I don't think the folks who are younger than me, who have grown up and been able to travel to Vietnam as you know, children and into their adulthood, I don't think there's such a schism for them. You know, Vietnam is another place, another home, you know. For me to travel to Vietnam just is this incredibly painful reminder that I don't belong there, and I'm told I don't belong here either. So it may not surprise you that I would prefer to travel somewhere else, you know, where I know I don't belong, and it doesn't matter. And, you know, it's not fraught with history. Personal history. So I go to Italy a lot. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So how do you think your identity as a Vietnamese woman has impacted your ability to be successful in different fields?
Well, I think we sort of began the interview, right, with this idea of whether I'm a stronger person because of my experiences as a refugee, as a Vietnamese American. And I really pushed back on that. I can tell you this. I am clearly, I have a plan A and a plan B. You know, my plan A was not my own plan, but I mean, well, it's rather, it's not a plan I want to ever revisit, but it's still there. I have a law degree, you know, I'm a lawyer. I am in many ways, I fear less because of it. You know, I feel like I do have a particular key into understanding so much of contemporary life, you know, from a simple thing like signing a lease, you know, to reading about the lawsuits that Trump has brought against the various states. I'm not fearful of the law either, right? Plan B, of course, is the writing. But it's unfair, I think, to characterize it in that way. I'm very, I think like some of my friends that I know who are both writers and lawyers, and of course, many of them are Asian American women, is that it's about, being able to, oh, this is a terrible way of putting it, but I do think it's true with respect to me. It's like being able to dodge the bullet wherever the bullet is coming from, you know? There have been so many instances during my writing career where I could have caved. I could have said, okay, I will write it the way that you want me to write it, editor, because it'll sell more books or it'll be easier for the reader. It will be a more successful book. I never gave in. Why didn't I give in? Because I knew I had a plan A. Fine, you don't want to publish my book? I will put it away. I will go back and I will temp as a lawyer. I know I can pay my bills, pay my student loans, take care of my day-to-day needs. I am not reliant solely on the book, on the creative side to live. And it's, so maybe you can look at that as a strength. Do you know what I mean? You can look at it as always making sure that you have your bases covered. Maybe that's a nicer analogy, a baseball analogy, as opposed to a bullet analogy, but I don't count on only one thing. Yeah.
Okay, I think this might be my last question.
Okay.
So what importance does storytelling have in your life, and what importance do you think it has in society?
I think storytelling in my life has to do with trying to understand very complicated, complex issues. You could tell someone to read the history of an enslaved person, or you can, which could be filled with facts, dates, places, acts. And in addition to that, if you also put in their hands a book, a work of fiction, a short story, a set of poems, that creates a space for them to imagine how it was for a particular enslaved person to exist in the world, to go on, to wake up one day after the other, to endure, to feel joy, to feel hope, to have faith, all the things that you have and that all humans have, no matter our condition. Yet, knowing the history of the context of their lives, and then to be invited into a story, a narrative space where you get to spend a period of your day thinking about that one or two or three characters, to be drawn in that way, I think is crucial, right? For really building what I had talked about earlier, which is empathy. So earlier I talked about history and the lack of knowledge of history, but the better answer, and I think the truer answer for me, is history has to be accompanied by a personal story. And perhaps that is also why there is, if you're living in a community right now, today, that is really homogenous, that has no one but folks who look exactly like you, who have had the exact or very similar family history to yours, and you can't even access a personal story of any from any other community, you're maybe that does explain your lack of empathy, you know? So really, it to me, storytelling has the ability and the possibility of evoking a space for empathy to emerge. And certainly within myself, I know that to be true. And I do think that really is gosh, it's really that the kind of the highest kind of hope that you can have for your stories, right? That it goes out to the world and it says, take a moment and see what it was like to be this Japanese woman, you know, to consider what it was like to love this man, this Lafcadio Hearn, and why, or why something akin to love emerge between them, you know? And yeah. And I think part of that, right, is this invitation to slow down your world, you know? And I mean that as a personal, every book that is worth reading is an invitation to you, the reader, to slow down, to stop looking at the screen, to spend some time alone with the words, and to imagine and to empathize.
Do you have anything else you want to say?
Is there anything else I want to say? I don't know. I feel like I want to say something about Houston. And even though I was disappointed by Texas as a whole, I know that the state of Texas has these incredibly diverse communities, Houston, Austin, and every time my mother and my younger sister still live in Houston. So every time I go back, I'm in some ways I'm pleasantly surprised, you know, that of how much is embraced by the city of Houston as a whole. And one of the clearest example, and it's of course is how incredibly vibrant the food scene is there, right? And it is one of the it is a way to invite people in, right? And once you have someone sitting at your table, that's when the stories can also begin, right? And because each dish comes with it a story, each cook comes with him or her a story. So that seems helpful. And I just, yeah. So in that sense, there's a little reserve of hope there to be found. And yeah, and I'm hoping that, you know, whoever is looking at this in the future can understand how precarious the United States feels on today, you know, that it's an experiment in democracy that has more or less been working. It's not perfect, but it felt like it was on the right path, and now it feels under attack. And it's incredible to me that the attack is coming from within the United States. No?